Hidden among the neighborhoods of Old Charleston sits locked away in plain sight, a foreboding place known only as the Old Jail.
So it fully operated as a jail from 1802 to 1936 or so. From 1936 to 1937, the building was then abandoned. In the next 60 so years, besides some storage and a couple of Spoleto events and a little bit of a museum for a very short time, the building sat mostly empty just to keep people out. And that's the irony of this, is that the building was built to keep people in and stood for at least a third of its life just keeping people out. After Hurricane Hugo, the building had suffered quite a large roof removal that rain poured in, and a lot of the plaster ceilings throughout the building collapsed in. So although the plaster walls and the masonry, we will say, survived, or at least in some condition, the ceilings, like in most houses, were deteriorated completely and gone. So after that, the housing authority, which owned the building at the time, put a roof back on it, luckily, and basically mothballed it for a while. When we found the building, there were a lot of structural issues. As I moved to Charleston after studying both architecture and structural engineering, and this became the building that was known as the one of the top structural challenges. So we had a huge opportunity, but huge challenges to save this building. Yeah, it's interesting to look at the history of how we were starting the American College of the Building Arts, a center that would teach the best craftsmen and reinstate craftsmanship and quality. Well, this building, clearly, of its time and period, was all about quality and craftsmanship. The stone, the iron, the plaster, the masonry, the huge timber trusses. It was built to stand and has done that. Even through neglect and abuse, it has stood here. So there was an opportunity to start to move the building in the opposite direction. It had literally come to a point where it was deteriorating away, structurally had some unstable areas, and we were able to start turning that around, using it kind of as a living laboratory for the American College of the Building Arts and the students.
While a college by day, by night the old jail takes on new life by offering ghost hunters a trip through dark Charleston.
Yeah, what's really been neat about this is, remember, a building that's closed up and literally does not have an identity has been one that has the opportunity to have great events here, like Halloween events and fundraisers, because people want to see in the building. The flip side of that, it's been one that's been so isolated, it's hard to utilize. And in this 13-year process, we got an opportunity to work with Bulldog Tours. Bulldog Tours is the only tour company that we're allowed to go through the building. They use the building from 7 at night to 11. They take you on a tour, and they're one of our largest sponsors.
Well, our most infamous resident was probably Miss Lavinia Fisher, who happened to be America's first serial killer. Now, the interesting part about her is this tiny, beautiful little thing, and in all the things that are written about this jail, Lavinia Fisher is described as being, on record, the most beautiful woman in Charleston County. All the women hated her, all the men wanted her, and that's probably why. But she would kind of flaunt that beauty, and she used that beauty to attain her victims. How she did that is she and her husband ran a place called the 6 Mile Inn.
Prospectors would come to the house, and they would ask my dad if they could go around with the Geiger counters out in the yard, because they heard there was a lot of, you know, jewelry and money out there buried from Mrs. Fisher.
And what would happen is they were highway robbers, so the people checking into the inn wouldn't necessarily check back out. And Lavinia would utilize that beauty of hers to have a question and answer session with the person to find out basically your travel itinerary and whether or not your wife was expecting you home and how much cash you had in your pocket and things packed up on your wagon to know whether it was worth her while to actually kill you, literally.
And my dad said, sure, you can go ahead out there. So one night they were out there, and Daddy thought, you know, the light might bother them, so he pulled the shade down. When he pulled the shade down, you know how the old shades used to do? They'd go flapping up, back up. Well, these shades did that, and those guys dropped their instruments, and they never came back for them, and I don't think they found any treasures either.
One of the wonderful antiques still left in the jail itself is this wheelchair that's original from 1820s. We believe that the person who sat in it was actually an incapacitated prisoner, but nonetheless, whether you were handicapped or not, as you can see, we locked y'all up together, equal opportunity and all that. But the wheelchair itself has been in the jail ever since. Now, you see, during the 1820s, we were collecting water from the jail was collected off of the roof in cistern barrels. This particular variety of water collection caused the inmates and a lot of jailers to suffer from cholera. And we believe that the man who had this chair actually died from the cholera epidemic. The interesting part is the wheelchair has remained in the jail all these years. It's still in fairly pristine condition considering it's from the 1820s. But the most interesting part about this wheelchair is the permanent rear end print here on the base of it. See, nobody sits in this chair. We don't sit in it at all because there is a spirit that likes this chair, and that is a permanent butt print because we don't dust it. That's the actual ghost that does that butt print. You will see on the front, you'll see a few scrapings from where his legs have been against the front of the wheelchair as well. These two are from the ghost, and he does occasionally like his little foot pad turned up, which he did this since last night because I just did tours the night before, and the wheelchair has changed its position once already as well as moved its foot paddle. So it in itself is almost a haunted item because the ghost tends to stick very close to his chair. He doesn't really manifest, I would say, but you do occasionally catch cold spots and orbs around it, and I have had people in my groups be terrified because the chair suddenly turned slightly and bumped them in the leg. Nothing harmful, but hey, something knocks you in the leg and there's nothing there, it's going to scare you out of your wits as well. And one of the more interesting ghosts of this old building that I like is our guard ghost. Our guard ghost likes these steps. He walks up and down them at night, usually comes up about 11:30, 12 o'clock, right around the time of closing. And he is a very large, ominous shadow of a man. And he will appear and walk up these steps to the second floor cell here, and he does sort of a peekaboo. He'll peer in right, he'll peer in left, and then this male ghost removes himself from that cell, walks up that third set of steps, and disappears at the top of the landing. Now, I've only had this happen in front of two actual tour groups, and it scared the daylights out of them so badly, all 20 people made it to the back patio and would not move from the patio. But the ghosts in here, not all of them are quite so ominous. Right now, we'll go into the basement here to my right, and the one young man we'll talk about is Jeremiah. He's the least intrusive of the ghosts that we try and communicate with here in the building, but he is definitely here. So let's go now into the basement, talk more about Jeremiah and some of the other ghosts that have been here at the jail, some of our more permanent visitors, if you will. Now, this room here, during the time of the jail's inception, while it was in operation, this was our morgue room. And I know it looks like a workroom now, but don't let that fool you. It truly was a morgue. At the time the jail was opened by 1880, 14,000 people had died here of being hanged or infectious disease. That's quite a great deal. And one of the more interesting ghosts that live here in the basement is a young boy we called Jeremiah. Now, Jeremiah is all of about 9 years old, and he came from the workhouse. That was because he was sickly, nobody wanted him as a slave. So the inmates, the trustees rather, the folks on good behavior and the guards, they took him in as sort of a little bit of a servant, and they would send him out with a list of errands every day, and that's how he earned his keep. Well, poor Jeremiah, just like the jailers and the inmates, he got cholera from the water supply, and poor Jeremiah passed away, and he resides here in the basement. Now, commonly on tours, Jeremiah comes and he tries to hold my hand, but the funniest thing he does is he's drawn to the crowd. He'll walk amongst the back end of the crowd. He creates cold spots about waist high. The other interesting thing Jeremiah does is toss little pebbles. And if he really, really likes you, you'll find a little stack of those pebbles in your pocket when you leave the jail here on one of our tours. At night, you know, after the tours are over, each of us gets to lock up the building all by ourselves. Several of the ghosts in the earlier part of the building, they just like to talk to you. They just like to play with you. But through the hallway here, this is when the fun and games begin. This is when the ghosts get right up on your ear and they start to talk to you and say your name. And my all-time favorite is because of my long hair. They play with my long hair all the time. So ghosts can be very interesting and amused. Eternity's a long time.
Once a place of sheer torment, now stands as a testament to the craftsmen of the city around them. And while the cells are vacant, these walls still have a voice.
So today, yeah, we have a, I think it's more for curiosity, but people rattle the doors and try to ignite the ghost and see what's happening.